Okay, so Yannick here. So I'm going to talk to you about what you should do to go offshore. I get I'm based in Ireland, where we got a lot of storms sent from the Caribbean, ending up north, and a lot of my clients are coming and they're asking me. So Yannick, I want to go to Spain because they all go offshore. They either go to 20 miles away maximum, or they just go across the Gulf of Biscay, that is 400 miles away, and they need to be ready. And they are coming for advice. And so the first advice that would be, okay, are your sails fit for this? So because you could have a very old set of sails, and even fixing them is not safe. They'll fail because when you're near the shore, you can choose your weather. But when you're 2 days away, you need to go through this window. And the first advice I would give is you need a third reef. Because when you get a third reef, everything is more quiet. The boat is more manageable. It's easier to live on board. So that would be the first one. And the second one is if you get into 30 knots, is your furling system in general safe? To me, it's not safe by experience. I discovered that if there are 30 knots and your furler is out, it's quite difficult to have this back rolled with the sail in one piece. So what I would recommend is inner forestay, and depending on your setup, you could have a furling system on the inner forestay to have a stay sail. But the second option would be that is a lot easier and cheaper to set up is forestay that you can release, and it would be Dynamo. I prefer Dynamo compared to a wire, because a wire would be banging against the mast when you store it along the mast. So it would be a Dynamo with a low friction timber at the bottom, and you could release this this forestay remotely from a stern, from the cockpit. And on this one, on this forestay, I would have a sail with hanks. You could have soft shackle, or you could have a spring hanks. And this inner forestay, this stay sail, I would have one or two reef. So basically, over 20, 25 knots, you could prepare this sail, just tie down on deck, and once there is more breeze, you can hoist this stay sail, and that would be the sail that you would use most of the time when it's going over 30, 35, or even more. Even that would delay the time you need your storm jib, because you would have a reef in it. It would be quite a robust sail. I would use patents as well, because that would prevent too much flapping. But that's so just to summarize, I would go for inner forestay, third reef, and that would be most of it. Code zero, if you got a code zero, you will need pretty small bow sprit as well, and a furling system. Because when there's some breeze, you could use this cut zero, but then you need to be in a hurry to go somewhere. So the last point I would develop is how easy is it to reef in my sail? Because you could have just a one-line reefing system. Well, it's fine, it's working. If you got an electric winch, it's a lot easier, because that's a very, very long line, and it's going up, down, at the front and the back of the sail. So if you've got a second reef to reef, that's about 20 meters of rope in your cockpit. And there is a lot more friction as well. So I would go just more simple. It's just a standard line on the leech, and on the luff, what I would have just a simple line that would go back to the cockpit with the channel. So you would have two separate lines to handle. because the line that is attached to the tacker on the reef is always very low. It's just basically to take the slack. You don't even need to winch it. And if ever you have to go to the mast to reef, what I would also recommend is on one side you would have a ring, but on the other side you would have a handle, so you can pull down the sail and you hold it, and then you get your ring attached to the horn. And on this horn, I would have also more punjitsu to prevent the ring from popping out. So basically, there are these three items I would recommend for going offshore. But for sails, just make sure you bring your sails to a sail anchor and just get them to be checked and ask, can he go in 30 knots? Is it reliable? And that's pretty. Simply is the best person to know if your sail is well able and fit to go into these type of conditions. So that's for this point. I can talk to you about some topic about sailing at night. There's something I discovered after maybe 30 years of sailing. Yeah, it's glow tape. And I bought a boat about 3 years ago. And when I bought the boat, it was in France. And it took about half a day to prepare the boat. And then we left for 600 miles. And we didn't have a clue about what sails we had on board. So we just opened up, we needed a jib, or here is a jib. And the first night, I discovered something that was just amazing. Claw tape. Could see the shape of my sail every time for years I needed a head torch and be blind for 5 minutes because I was looking at the shape of my sail trimming. But this claw tape is just amazing because you can see exactly the depth of your sail, the twist, and that's something is so handy. And even I've been using it for some jammers because they are pretty good jammers. Like if you're on the spinnaker, you need to know straight away where is my tack line, and you got a tiny mark that blows at that tack line or T, and then the halyard, the masthead or the fractional. So you can use it for different things, even for switchboard at night if there's a critical switch you want to use, but don't put it everywhere because then you'll be blind because it will be too much light. So using this, you can use a red light as well for inside for doing navigation, even if paper charts they don't like too much red light. But if you double-handed the other guy who's driving, on the emergency for 5 minutes. I also always keep a good torch that you can see miles away in my pocket, because if ever I believe I'm kept on, I always kept on, but sometimes you keep on to the wrong thing, and if ever you end up overboard, you can get this torch to light up, and you can point at the boat if you're the one handed on. Or if you're single-handed, solo, you might have some AIS that is going to show signals to some screen to the boat beside. The other thing that I want to talk about sailing at night is spinnakers. Most of spinnakers are white. I don't know why. But I like a bit of color, but it's very handy because when it's a very sunny day, a white spinnaker is very hard on your eyes. If you don't have any shade, it's very difficult. Your eyes are crying after a while. So during the day, it's not the best, but at night, a white spinnaker is really the worst thing. It's like a ghost because you can't see any, there is no contrast. If you got a darker color, you get a bit more shadow, and your sail is going to be a bit more visible to swim at night. So when you order a new sail, or Sure, you got a choice of sailor on board. At night, use a darker sailor. That's my advice. And that's about it for sailing at night. And I'm just going to show you how we need to secure your buttons, sails, mainsail, and jib. We'll see this video starting now. So first thing, here's what you need. The wax thread, got a small spool, needle, scissors, lighter, and drill. But the drill bit has to be just the size of the needle, and the needle can't be too big because the thread will go through the hole otherwise. So make sure it's not too big a hole. And when you drill, you need to drill through where you got the most of layers of fabric. And in this case, I've been drilling three holes in the button because it's a very wide flat button. But otherwise, you can drill just beside the button for the wax thread. You can also use an awl to make a hole into the fabric. So we just need to double up a wax thread and tie a knot, a figure eight knot to the end. And cut and burn it, melt it with a lighter or hot knife. So I always start on the outside and not in the middle because usually in the middle, the hole is a tiny bit bigger and a knot can go through it. You do just a figure eight, basically. So just make sure it's very tight. So you go back to the first hole, you got the knot already, and you'll do another knot to stop it. Just make sure the knot is as close as possible to the button. Okay. Here we go. And then you can pull the two tails for cutting it and melting it. And that's it. So you should really put this on every button, except when you're racing inshore, you might change the top button for a softer, stiffer one. So there is no reason not doing this over all your buttons when you go offshore, because it can create a lot of damage. Okay, that's it for this button securing.